One quick note is I noticed outside it says trails. We're not talking about trails today, so. So my talk today is on Microsoft SQL Server to Postgres. The company I work with, we're currently in this process now. We're near the ending stages of it. We should be done by the end of the year. My name's Lewis Royster. Just a quick background about me, I guess. Spent some time in the Army after I left high school. After some time there, I decided it was time to move on. So I went to college, got a degree in computer science. I'm currently with the company I've been with now for 2 years, so I actually have 2 years of professional development experience. Of those 2 years, I've been working primarily with Postgres for about 18 months. All right. A little bit about the company I work for. Small company in Ohio. We only have 60 employees. Of those 60 employees, we have 14 developers. We have 5 people in our QA department, and we have 3 people in our T department. Our code base, all of our code is written in Visual Studio. Most of it is VB.net. We do have some C Sharp. We do have some JavaScript, but the big chunk of it is VB.net. The decision to go from SQL Server to Postgres was primarily a business decision because we are going to save about $1 million a year in licensing and fees. So once you're talking about numbers that big, it was really a no-brainer to make that switch. Throughout this whole process, I'll be talking about our Postgres progress team. Our Postgres team, it's been an average of 3 developers. We've had more at times, we've had less than times, but on average, we've had 3 developers throughout the whole process. And we started full-time conversion process in October of 2015. So right now we're about 18 months into our conversion process. We're hoping to be completely done, all of our clients and databases on Postgres by the end of the year. All right, this is a little bit of what we're talking about today. We'll go over our planning phase, things to help us get ready. We'll go over our prep, the things that we did to get ready to convert to Postgres. We'll go over our conversion process, our testing, and then last, how we plan to roll out. All right, first is planning. We decided to switch to Postgres. We knew we wanted to go with an open source database. It came down really to two. It came down to MySQL and Postgres. After doing research in both of them, we just decided that Postgres was better fit for our needs. So that's what we went with. Next, we started researching IDEs. Again, this decision really came down to two, is pgAdmin or DataGrip. We decided to go with DataGrip. There are a couple people in our company that still use pgAdmin. For the most part, myself included, I use DataGrip. Next is research hosting on AWS. This morning, they had a keynote talk on AWS, and Mark had said something about the AWS schema conversion tool. That was not out yet whenever we started our conversion process. We heard rumors of it. We actually talked to AWS when they were going to release it. But when we were ready to start, it wasn't out yet. So we just went ahead with our conversion process without that. And lastly, in our planning phase is time and resource estimates. How long was it going to take us to do all this? We had no idea. I don't even know why we were estimating at this point, because we had no idea. All right, next we got in our preparation stage. Again, we formed our Postgres team. At the time we formed, it was 3 developers. It was myself and 2 others. Next, we did time estimates and meeting with the business. We spent a lot of time doing time estimates at this point, probably too much time. After we were done doing that, we did more time estimates. No, really, there were a lot of time spent trying to do time estimates at this phase. There was a lot of, you know, if we have X amount of developers on Postgres full time, then it'll be all converted in X amount of time. The problem with this, at this point in stage, we had no statistical data at all. There was just nothing to tell us how long it was gonna take. So we had nothing to go off. And really, we spent a lot of time doing that with no point. Which brings me to one of my points today, is Hofstadter's Law. Being in the software development community, I'm sure a lot of you have heard this, but it states that it'll always take longer than you expect, even when you take into account Hofstadter's Law. I put this up here because if there's one piece of advice I can give to anybody who is going to convert from SQL Server to Postgres, is it's going to take way longer than you think. Take your time estimates. You can double them and triple them, and it'll still probably take longer than that. Oh, yeah, there we go. All right. Then we came to the question of how are we going to deal with active development and conversion at the same time? This is a big deal for us. We had a lot of projects going on when we decided to do this. So the first thing that we did is we thought that we could shrink this, how many projects that we have. You know, we may had 4, 5, 6, 7 projects at that time. If we take it down to 1 or 2, two things would happen. One, we would free up resources to work on Postgres, essentially converting Postgres faster. Not knowing a whole lot at this stage, we just thought we'll stay out of active development. You know, whatever modules or whatever part of the software that was currently being actively developed on, the Postgres team would just stay out of there. Neither one of these worked very well. Actually, neither one of them worked at all. We'll talk more about that a little bit later. Next, in our preparation stage, we built our Postgres progress tool. This was probably one of the more important things that we did. This is it. Well, this is the interface for it. This is written in C#. Basically, a couple features on here, and I'll get into this more later, but if you look at the top, there's a timer. Again, we were real big on time estimates. But if you look at the search box, there's a little, you can search for a procedure, any procedure name. You could also search by database. You could search by the type, you know, it could be a view, sort procedure, trigger. Once you got whatever script that you wanted, you would hit start task. That would then bring it up to the top. That top view box is all of the things that you would be working on. You could have one procedure in there. You could have 25. The functionality of this really is once you hit start on that procedure, it would then do a git pull from the server. It would bring it down to your local. It would open it up in any IDE that you were using. In my case, it would be Datagrip. You would convert it. Once you're done converting it, we would F5 it. And then once you clicked finish, it would then do a push back to the server. This is how we kept track, so that way the three developers didn't end up working on the same script at the same time, or you know, someone it was in the process of working at it and somebody else did a pull against it. That was really it for that. We'll get more in depth in this tool later. It does some better things. All right, so now we are ready to start converting. We did all the planning that we could, and we did all the prep that we could, and we did 1,000,010 time estimates. So we're where to start? We didn't know. You know, we tried to look into other companies that had switched from Microsoft SQL Server to Postgres. We didn't find a whole lot. There wasn't a lot of documentation on it. So at this point in time, we didn't really know where to start. First things we did is we used the Amazon Web Services, the database migration service, along with a tool. It was written in Go to migrate all our databases from SQL Server to Postgres. What this did is it made a copy of our databases, put it on our Postgres server. It also picked up all the tables. So essentially all our tables now were on Postgres. What it didn't pick up is any type of script, no stored procedures, views, triggers, functions, anything like that. Next, we created another tool. This is also written in Go to convert our scripts to Postgres. And I wish this was as easy as it sounds, that it just ran it through and converted all our scripts to Postgres. That was not the case. All this really did is it pulled all of our SQL scripts, it would run them through this tool, and it would spit them out as Postgres scripts. a couple things that it would add. It would add like the replace I can't think of the name right now. Anyways, it would add the script name. It would add the parameters. It looked for a couple little things like in SQL is null, is coalesce in Postgres. So it would change all the is nulls to coalesce. Yes. But that's about all it did. All of those scripts still needed to be gone through and really rewrote to use in Postgres. So we had 10,000 SQL Server scripts, and we just started converting them as fast as we could. We really had no direction at this point in time, and this is probably one of the bigger mistakes that we made along the way. All right, so this was a dashboard that we had created on that Postgres progress tool. Just real quick, going over it, if you look, it'll say how many scripts we had, how many scripts we had left to convert, the overall process, the different type of scripts that we had, and then at the bottom would have the developers' names and how many scripts that they converted that day. Really, the big part of this is that overall bar. What happened was we had those 10,000 SQL scripts, and we were only focused with converting them as fast as we could. That's all that we cared about. So naturally, all of the easy scripts got picked up first to convert. So we were converting all the views, the very easy stored procedures, things like that. So over time, through the first couple weeks that we were doing this, that overall progress bar went up drastically. I mean, there was 1 week, I think we did 13% of all our stored procedures in a week. And that worked fine until we hit about 80%. And then at 80%, we had all of our difficult stored procedures left, and it just came to a screeching halt. So we were doing 10, 12, 5% a week, and then we were doing 1% a week, 1.5% a week. So it was not a realistic tracker at all. This is very far from realistic. All right. Dealing with development while converting. I said that we'd come back to this, and now we're here. Again, I said that the business was going to shrink, how many active development projects that we had going on. That did not happen. Actually, the exact opposite of that happened. We got more projects. And then our second was to just stay out of areas that were actively being developed against. That did not happen as well. What we found is that we may have development going on in Module A of our software, but that module also touches Module B and Module C. So it was really impossible just to stay out of places that were being actively developed. That's where our Postgres Progress tool really came to help us. This is probably the most important part of this tool. First thing what we did is we set up triggers on our Microsoft. Anytime that somebody got a stored procedure, a view, anything like that, changed it, and then committed it, that trigger would run, and it would trigger the activated by column in here. So what happened is we would know if we were in an area or going to an area that we were going to try to convert those scripts to Postgres, we knew that they were actually being developed against and not to touch those. The second thing that triggered is it sent an email if that script had already been converted. So if I had converted a script already and another developer had to go in that script in SQL Server and change it, it would send an email to me, it would send an email to the developer that was currently working on it in SQL, and we would then get together, talk, figure out how we were gonna implement those changes. Most of the times it came down to, hey, I saw that you changed this, and they were like, yeah, I'm done. I would then pull up the SQL and add any changes that were done in Postgres. It worked out great, though. That was probably one of the best things that we did as far as being able to organize the active development with the Postgres. All right, so we kind of reached like a plateau or stopping point at this point in time. What happened, as I said before, with that progress tracker, we were going from 10-12% a week down to 1 or 2% a week. That came down, and as that progressed, the percentage of weekly we were getting done was shrinking. And also we had a lot of active development going on. It was no longer viable just to, let's just convert scripts as fast as we can. It wasn't working for us. So we switched focus. I'll call this conversion 2.0. First thing is we changed our focus. We went from, hey, let's take these 10,000 stored procedures, convert them as fast as we can, to let's start going through our software module by module, and let's try to convert it module by module. Instead of looking at a big picture, we broke it down into smaller bits. This is another very important thing that we did, is we set up is using Postgres in our web config. Is using Postgres is a bit. If it was in a Postgres web config, it was a 1. If it was in a SQL web config, it was a 0. What this would do is just let our code know what database basically we were working with. An example of kind of how this would work, is there are spots in our code where we build out dynamic SQL. Obviously, building out dynamic SQL as SQL is not going to run in Postgres. So at that point, you would put an if statement in. It was if SQL helper is using Postgres, then we would write out that dynamic SQL in Postgres. If it was not using that, if that came back as false, then it would then execute the regular dynamic SQL. That comes into play later on down the line too, but that was a very important thing that we did, was being able to have our code talk to Postgres or SQL at the same time. Again, I'm going to kind of touch on this, but yeah, this is where we really shrunk our focus, and we started going through our software module by module. Instead of having that broad, let's all these developers, all the Postgres developers, focus on module A, because there's nobody developing in module A right now. There's obviously little problems with that. I'm going to get into those a little bit later. All right. Another thing that happened when we shrunk our focus is we started to find these little nuances, the things that SQL and Postgres are just a little bit different on. As I said before, as we were going through and we were converting as fast as we could, we would convert a stored procedure and then we would hit F5. And if that stored procedure executed, we considered that converted. That really wasn't converted. We had no way, we didn't test it at all yet. There was no way of knowing if that thing actually worked. So once we started limiting our focus and doing it module by module, we really started to find that although these scripts are executing, they're not really working. An example of that is in Postgres, when you have parameters, if you set your parameters to a value, if you want to set a parameter to null, that parameter has to come last in your parameter list. In SQL Server, it doesn't matter. So that could be first, it could be third, it could be wherever in your parameter list. So we had to go in and change the way that our parameters were getting passed from our code to our Postgres. We had no way of knowing that before. All right, I am going very quick. All right, next we're gonna go into testing. Some things that we did for testing. First is we didn't take into account how big of a task testing was going to be. I think that when we got into this, when we were planning and even into our conversion process, we thought that converting all of those scripts would be the biggest hurdle that we had to overcome. Really, it was testing. Testing was long. It was probably longer, just as long, if not longer, than converting all those scripts. Next, and this was another thing that we did that was outstanding, is we got the whole company involved. Again, we're a small company. We only have 60 employees total. And when we were looking at testing, we decided that we have trainers, we have a sales team, we have documentation. we have all these people that use this software every day. They know it like the back of their hand. So we're getting in testing, why not get them involved too? Why not to have them click through it? Why not have them go into it and use it like they would any other day and find bugs with it? So that's what we did. We got everybody involved. So the first thing that we would do in our press, in our testing process, is as developers, we would click through whatever module that we were sending into testing. We look through click crashes, high level things, really just little mistakes, things like that. Once the dev clicked through it, we knew everything was converted. Once they clicked through it, it would then go to those other employees. The trainers, the documentation, all those other employees, our rule of thumb for them were they needed to have three people click through whatever module we were working on. So if we were working on module A, if that was the one we sent to them, then trainer one would click through the whole entire thing once. And they would add data. They would do a little bit deeper dive than what the developers did. Then trainer two would do it. Then trainer three would do it. They found bugs. They would send them to us. We would then fix them and send them back. We did find a lot of bugs this way. We found a ton of bugs this way. Like I said, when the developers went through it, it was mostly click crashes that we were looking through. We didn't get deep in it at all. So developer clicked through it, sent it to the trainers. The trainers clicked through it three times. We fixed all the bugs. They said it was good. And then I went to our QA team. Our QA team still found a lot of bugs. Our QA team really dove deep into the data, making sure, like, for instance, that tables were coming back with the same data in the same order, things like that. They really got deep into the testing, and they found a decent amount of bugs. Again, it was the same process. They would send the devs the bugs, we'd fix them, send them back. One of the things that we did in this process, though, is going back to that is using Postgres. Our code was now set up to use Postgres and SQL, and we were making changes in our code. So they would go through and test Postgres, and it would clear, and then they would go through and test SQL. So we tested for both. After it cleared Postgres, we would test again for SQL. We didn't get a lot of SQL bugs. Actually, there was less than five probably per module. But what we did is we found a whole ton of bugs that were in production. We probably found close to 100. They're little things that just our clients hadn't found. So once QA then cleared it on Postgres and SQL, we would release that module. We sent it into production. That module was then in production. It could work with both SQL or Postgres, but all our clients are currently still on SQL. Once that this happened, and this is kind of going back to how we tried to keep the active development and Postgres away from each other. Once this happened, this module would then go what we call a lockdown state. Once it was in, it wasn't really a lockdown state. What's happened is once it will take, I'll say module A, for example, and module A has been converted to Postgres. It's been tested for Postgres. It's in production. So if another team gets a project and they need to go into module A, they are now responsible for converting that, both Postgres and Microsoft. So if they have any changes to stored procedures they need to do, they have to do it to both. Tables, same thing. Any changes to tables they have to do it to both. Once they are done doing their development, it then goes to QA, and QA again will test both. They'll test for the Postgres, they'll test for the SQL. All right, deploying. This is where this is using Postgres is going to really help us. We plan to roll out database by database, even kind of client by client. We're planning to do a slow and very long rollout. So what'll happen is we'll start rolling out small clients first. We'll take clients that our databases aren't very big, and we'll put them on Postgres. The plan is to wait, could be a couple weeks, 2 months, to see if they find any bugs. See if they, you know, anything that happened, make sure everything happens well. Any bugs that we get, we'll fix them. And then we'll roll out more clients. The plan is that we'll roll out small clients, we'll wait a decent amount of time, we'll roll out more clients, we'll wait a decent amount of time, until we shrink that time, eventually getting to a point where we just flip a switch and roll out all our clients. Okay, so this is just some mistakes that we made, some things that I think we did well that we could probably take away from here. One of the biggest mistakes was time estimates. Again, we spent a lot of time doing time estimates. It was really a lot of wasted time of doing time estimates. Another thing is that the business is always pushing to do more work, but with less resources. Like I said before, we were planning on shrinking down the amount of active development that we had to focus on Postgres, when actually the exact opposite happened. We had more projects. And then having too wide of an area of focus. Our just going in and converting the scripts as fast as we could without having a good testing plan in place, it didn't really help us at all. What we found is that during that process, I would convert a script, and then when I went in the module to make sure that it was working to test it, I basically just had to rewrite that script again. So going through those and just converting as fast as we could was not great. Some of the good things we did was getting the whole company involved. That really helped us a lot. Any time you get more people involved, I think is great. The tools that we built internally to help us, those were also a big help. That Postgres progress tool, not so much for the get and the push, that is whatever, but the way that we use that to track and the way that we put those triggers on there to track, that was a big help. That really helped us. AWS does have that tool now. I haven't personally used it, but I heard it's great. For us, it just wasn't out when we started this conversion. And then when we narrowed our focus, instead of looking at it as a big picture, we just broke it down and went module by module. And that was really one of the best things that we did. It helped us get through the conversion process faster, but also helped us test along the way. I talked really fast. But anyway, so we have a lot of time for questions.
I'm sure a lot of people have questions, so we have at least another 10 to 15 minutes.
Yeah, and I'm going to put my email up here. If any of you have any questions outside of here that you would like, you're more than welcome to email me. Also, there is a whole Postgres team, so if I can't answer it, somebody in my company probably can. Speaking of that, this is Dave, who is also a Postgres developer with my company, so I'm sure we can answer any questions you have.
Now that you have the SCT tool from AWS, did you try converting any of your databases into that?
We did not. We were basically almost done with the conversion process by the time that came out. We started October 2015, that's really full time when we started, and we had mostly everything converted in about a year. It wasn't working, but it was converted. So I personally have not used that AWS tool, though. Go ahead.
You kind of mentioned that at one point you guys started noticing a lot of nuances. Was any of that related to performance? Like, did you notice some procedures were taking longer or shorter than before?
Yeah, actually, Dave can probably talk more about this than I can.
There were a couple performances, but a lot of it was more with the data that was being returned. One thing in particular is the case-sensitive searching versus the case-sensitive searching in SQL. That was a big concern for us. We started noticing it. At that time, we also started using a tool in Notepad++. Once we found a situation, we used that because there's a better searching in the inside the scripts to find all the occurrences of things that would do that. For example, the like for is case sensitive, and a lot of times we want to do I like compare in Postgres. So we use Notepad++ to find all the occurrences of like, the word like, and you know, some of it, it was comments and we had to sort through it, but you know, it found all, you know, a couple hundred different cases of that we could go in easily and make the change and know, oh, these are the scripts we have to change easily.
And also, just one point. So I think, don't feel like you guys spent a lot of time that you could have probably saved this game conversion tool.
Yeah.
Because it would have saved you time on the easy stuff, but I think you mentioned that last 20% that was really complicated. That's the stuff that probably wouldn't have been able to.
Yeah, it wouldn't. I mean, we've used other comparison tools before, and they work, but like you said, it's once you get in the real complex stored procedures, it's not really going to do you that much good. Good.
Speaking of performance, did moving from SQL Server to Postgres alter the amount of hardware you needed to run your servers?
I think it shrunk it, didn't it?
I think so. I mean, yeah. It also the cost savings will allow us to add extra as more clients come on or for backup. Too, with, that'll help also in the long way. It's more the IT question that you have to ask around.
Yeah, we kind of had the Postgres, this whole conversion, broken down in three parts, where IT, developers, and QA. The developers really, the IT really handled all the database stuff. We didn't touch that as developers. We were mainly focused on just primarily converting those scripts. And QA obviously was in testing. So we know a little bit about the database stuff, but
yeah,
probably not a ton.
That's more that department of our company.
Go ahead.
The first part, if there's any employees in the desert, you have a little edge silver for it.
Yeah.
It would be the first where, in hindsight.
Yeah. So the company being so small, our development area is really kind of flat. Like we don't have a development manager. Our development, our IT, everybody, we report straight to the owner of the company. So when these time estimates and everything, it would just be whatever, you know, we would have like a team lead on Postgres, that would go and talk to him about these time estimates. And it got really, goofy at some points, but you know, it is what it is. So
once we started explaining though, you know, it was a lot of the communication saying, hey, you know, this is why it is because we got to this, you saw this big jump because all the easy stuff was done first. Now we're getting the more complex and we're doing more of the testing and these little things like that came about.
We tried to tell him as much, and he understood, like we tried to tell him like, this is a major project. Like if this fails, this would cost us losing clients, which cost us losing money. You know, we lose enough clients, we're going to eventually go under.
You're getting more projects at the same time.
Yeah. We dealt with it.
It's been a balancing act.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I think he was next. I'm sorry.
What version of SQL did you guys convert from? And how much data were you talking about?
I know that we were using 2005. And as far as the data, I don't know the data size.
I don't think we can resolve it.
But yeah. This was cheaper than upgrading in 2014.
It was cheaper, yes, exactly. And like I said, in the long run, they estimated it was going to save $1 million a year on server costs, licenses, and everything.
Especially
like that.
Especially the licensing cost changes.
Yeah, and
cores and all of that.
So. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the money was a motivating factor to switch.
We're also looking at the technology stack as a whole. So it's not just the database, it's also the front end that's being worked on also. So there's a plan to be a little more flexible, a little more, you know, reduce our costs in the long run.
As far as going forward, you said more
conversion tool you have written internally.
Yes.
Will that, what percentage of the script will it convert on a new database you want to convert?
As far as the progress tool or the?
No, not the progress. The script, the basic procedures.
The one that took it and?
Videos and all that stuff, yeah.
How long did it take?
No, did you said you wrote internally a tool, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So if you're taking on a new database conversion from SQL Server to Postgres, what percentage of the scripts will it convert successfully?
So as far
I know always that you got to go and do some manually for some of the complex procedures.
Not a lot. I mean, probably what, like 2%. It would take that SQL script. It would then start to build out a Postgres script. One of the things it would do is like the create or replace function, whatever that script name was. If there's parameters in there, it would add those, and it would add the body of the script. But really,
simple pattern replacement.
Yeah, exactly. That's all it was.
That's all.
We
still go in and like remove the begin and an if statement, remove the begin and then change the end to an end if. And
so this was just a dumb conversion.
Yeah.
Logical.
Yes.
Yeah, it was to get you like along the way. You don't have to do the whole thing by hand.
It was, yeah. That's all it was.
To kind of translate it halfway, then you can start to.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You had your hand up, correct? Yeah, procedures. I don't know tables off the top of my head, but I can tell you it is a lot. I mean, I personally know tables that have 35,000 rows. So, I mean, it was big. Yeah, I don't know how many tables off the top of my head.
And then to follow up, someone else had talked about, like, the business side of it, like, some of the decision-making. Like, so when you guys were at the very beginning,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
He
made it.
Well, we're not going to take that advice. We're going to go ahead and add more features and do this.
Yeah.
That's kind of what happened.
So, what happened? We're in the medical software business, basically, and it's actually educators. So we look at like resident doctors when they're in their residency, and there's an agency that oversees that. That agency, like right around the time that we started Postgres, just mandated all these new rules. We had to implement them in our software. Yeah. There wasn't like, in a perfect world, we would have shrunk that down, but it was because of that happened. I mean, we had to have projects go on. So. Absolutely. Anyone else? I think you've had your hand up for a while. I'm sorry. I'm trying to get everybody.
You mentioned you've updated 10,000 scripts.
Uh huh.
What kind of scripts? 10,000 scripts?
Yeah.
Do you contact the square or?
No, they were on this slide. Let me go back a couple. Let me see if I can.
Yeah.
There it is, right there. So, yeah, we had. It's like a little over 7,000 stored procedures, 1,300 functions, 900 views, and 100 triggers. That was all. That's all of our SQL.
So it seems that a lot of logic of your application was probably is in
the database. Yeah, absolutely. You are 100% right. A lot of our logic, it was just the way it was. I've been at the company for 2 years. Dave, I think he's only been there a year. So all of this logic was definitely written before we got there. But yes, our SQL does perform a lot of logic for our software. I don't think so. One of the big problems that we met, like functionality wise, was pivot tables, actually. Pivot tables in SQL, there's not a really good fix for them in Postgres. We ended up using crosstab, which probably wasn't the best. Honestly, those scripts probably should be rewrote to take the pivot out of them. But other than that, not really. I think most of the logic, most of the functionality of SQL, we found a way to do it in Postgres. I think we got a couple more minutes. Go ahead.
So, pardon me, you were moving to Microsoft hardware base?
We are currently, yeah.
On Microsoft, you're just obviously with SQL Server.
Yeah.
And performance wise, you're okay with that and stuff like
that? So we're making changes to our code as well. Like I said, everything right now is Visual Studio. The current projects that are underway are actually getting developed with Angular 2. And we're hoping to make a switch more towards Angular 2 and hopefully maybe open source. Unfortunately,
our software is so large and so, you know, there's been a lot, several years of development.
More or less, the database is going to stay on a Microsoft platform.
Databases are going to go to AWS. They're on AWS now. Our Microsoft are on AWS. And then they'll say AWS. They'll say AWS.
So would you move to RDS or run Postgres
yourself? I'm sorry. I don't know. Does he have it set up in EC2?
I don't know. All right.
I'm not positive. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah. How about moving the actual data? Did that cause any headaches or
more than this part? No. That tool really and that database migration service that Amazon has really helped. We can actually convert all that stuff in less than an hour. So every one of our databases can be ran through that tool in less than an hour. The one thing that it's not an issue, but with tables, if somebody went into a table and added a column to that table, they didn't get picked up automatically, and it didn't get picked up by that tool. We then basically have to do a database refresh and run it through that database migration service and our tool again to pick up those table changes. Go ahead.
How do you find the IDEs for Postgres like pgAdmin and datagrid compared to the SQL Server?
Bad. I was actually going to put that in here, and I didn't. So we use SQL Server with SQL Prompt. As far as the IDE itself, I like Datagrip, it's fine, but they have nothing that compares to SQL Prompt. And I'm still developing SQL, and I use SQL Prompt a lot. They didn't have anything that really compared to SQL Prompt. It's not bad, I really like Datagrip, it's just not as good. And
they're adding features slowly, and listening to the community there.
They have a new build coming out, I think, fairly soon. So, over here. Yeah. Okay. What? Say that again. Okay.
To analyze the scripts, you mean?
No, analyze the script. Your code is running, right? Your developer ran a SQL problem, even some of the servers. It pulls something on the database side and store it, right? You don't have SQL profiler, so even if you're not familiar with the code, you know what's running in the database, right? You can just have to go forward and start on the database. You need to keep them in the state. That's what SQL Server needs to cover. Communicated database developer who doesn't work on the code side, they know what's going on in the database. They know what the code is for. This story prop, that story prop, this story data can be back and forth. In Postgres, what do you
Yeah.
You have to find the parallels in the open source world also, and there are a lot of companies that support Postgres with their tools, and you know, this is some research that you have to do.
Actually, Enterprise DB has a tool to do exactly that.
Yeah.
That's good feedback for the community to put some emphasis into those part of the things. And the more we hear from people who are coming over from the other side, that's the feedback we like to hear. So you know, maybe I can talk to you afterwards.
There's also a talk in 10 minutes on PL profiling.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
And that's definitely going inside the black hole and figuring out how the performance is. A quick question. Did you consider taking any of your tools and making it available to the community? Because you don't use it anymore. You're done with the job.
Well, yeah.
We'd have to talk with the owner and go from there. Like I said, you know, Beyond Compare is a tool that we use also.
Yeah, that's my favorite tool.
To compare
yeah.
the scripts. It gives us kind of the basic of the script so we can see if, you know, we dropped an if block or something like that. That's the one tool, like I said, Notepad++ was a huge help in searching through all the scripts.
So very last question. And you know, looking back now, like you were doing a conversion of one-to-one databases.
Mm-hmm.
If you had gone and looked at a small application like your deployment plan and worked backwards from that to do the conversion, how would that change your scope?
I think it probably would have saved some time. Like I said, what happened is we had such a big scope that we went in and converted everything. Yeah, and we had no idea if that really worked or not. And then we were finding out as we were going through it, it doesn't work. So it kind of, you know, there's some things, I think you would have had to go wide for a little bit in the beginning, but narrow your focus real quick.
So you start with the scope and then focus on
yeah.
one application. And
yeah,
exactly. Exactly.
okay, we're out of time.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you guys for coming.